pointed your Bible towards heaven with me today, just shout, I want more of him. That should be every child of God's desire, is to want more of him. Because the more of him you get, the less of the world that you want. The less desire that you have of the world, the more of him that you get. Repeat this with me this morning. Say, I thank God today for the word of God. Today, I'll be taught the uncompromised, the unchanging, the infallible, indestructible seed of the word of God. I can do what God says I can do. I can have what God says I can have. And I am what God says I am. For my Bible is God's word speaking to me. Look to your neighbor. Say, neighbor, the Bible, I said the Bible is God's supernatural word speaking to you. Be a doer of the word, not just to hear the word. Wave that word around, the rave it around. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Glory. Thank God for his supernatural word. Kind of caught you off a little bit. We've been going and doing it the same way. Once in a while, I like to throw a little extra in there, kind of just so we won't be the same all the time. Amen. We're talking on the subject of the Holy Spirit. And, you know, I thought I would be done with this a couple of weeks ago. But just as I pray on this and listen to the Holy Spirit, there's just so much more that we need to talk about and bring out the importance of staying full of the Holy Spirit. And our text is in Ephesians 5:18. Says, be not drunk with wine, for there's excess, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. The word filled there means a continued filling of the Holy Spirit. We need to always be continued filled with the Holy Spirit. And when we read the Word of God, we're getting more revelation of the Holy Spirit living inside of us. And let's go over here to John's Gospel this morning and look at a verse of Scripture in John's Gospel, chapter 7. And verse 37 says in Jesus here on the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out saying, if anyone thirsts, anybody thirsty this morning? Amen. Don't ever lose your thirst. Amen. Don't ever lose your thirst for the kingdom of God. If anyone thirsts, let him come unto me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart or out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. We talked about that. There's more than one river. Rivers continue flowing of the Holy Spirit. And I like to kind of look at it this way. When you look at rivers flowing and debris, trees along the riverbanks, whatever, and if you've got a flowing river, if limbs are broken off, leaves come off and fall into the waters, the river will take it right on downstream. Whatever falls into the moving water, flowing river, it moves on down the stream. But if you've got a pond or a lake and trees planted around that, so four things fall into that pond or lake, it gets stagnant. And if you notice ponds and lakes and things like that around the edges, a lot of times it gets green. Algae sets in. But see, as a child of God, we don't want no algae sitting in us. We don't want no debris staying with us. No sin staying in our lives. So if you're staying full of the Holy Spirit, you're having rivers of living waters flowing through your life. And whatever junk tries to get on you, it'll just flow right on out of you. Amen. It'll just keep flowing right on out of you. That's how good God is. Amen. He's put himself in us to become a living, flowing river on the inside of us to keep things flowing out of us. And you know, the Holy Spirit is what we call refreshing. It's always refreshing. Every day you have a refreshing Holy Spirit himself, God the Father through Jesus Christ by the Holy Spirit, living on the inside, brings a refreshing. Every day you should be refreshed. Amen. Because he is the refresher. He is the refresher. And it says here again, He says, he who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believe in him would receive. But the Holy Spirit was not yet given because Jesus was not yet glorified. Amen. We're talking about the old covenant here. Jesus, through the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Jesus spent 33 and a half years teaching and sharing, I'm going to be leaving, but I'm not going to leave you comfortless. I'm going to send back the Holy Spirit. Go with me to John's Gospel, chapter 14. He says in verse 26, he says, I'm going to leave you, but I'm going to leave you comfortless. Matter of fact, he's trying to get their attention to understand, and they really didn't understand all that Christ was talking about. And so he was telling us, well, I'm going to depart, but I'm going to come back and live in you. That's the bottom line. That's what he was talking about. I'm going to leave you. But see, they were sad when they heard the words from Jesus talking about leaving and leaving them there. And they didn't like that. But Jesus tried to continue to comfort them by saying, but I'm coming back. I'm coming back. You know, it's kind of like today. You know, he says, I'm coming back again. Jesus himself, Holy Spirit, but Jesus is coming back. Amen. He's coming back to take us out of this place one day. Or if we don't go, if we die before the rapture, we'll go and meet him. But he's definitely coming back. I said, he's definitely coming back. But the Holy Spirit, oh, how powerful the Holy Spirit is, and that lives inside of us. And, you know, he guides you and he leads you. And we need to be more sensitive of the Holy Spirit. And what we've been talking about is beginning to get a revelation of who he is inside of us, because we all have to make decisions every day. And we should always make the decisions being led and guided by the Holy Spirit. Dad Hagin said this many times over the years, and he said, you know, if you listen to the Holy Spirit, he'll make you rich. Amen. Not just in money, but he'll make you rich in everything you do. Amen. You listen to the Holy Spirit, he'll hear you, he'll heal your family. Amen. He'll take care of your needs. Amen. Praise God for you. Listen to the Holy Spirit, he'll move you when it's time for you to be moved. In certain, he'll position you where you need to be positioned, in other words. Whether it's from one job, take it to another, whatever, he'll position you just where you need to be if you listen to the Holy Spirit. But it says here in John's Gospel, chapter 14, in verse 26, but the helper is the Holy Spirit. The helper here means counselor, comforter, advocate, intercessor, strengthener, stand by, means he's working on our case. He's working on my case. He's my strengthener. He's my standby. He's everything. I said, he's my comforter. Don't ever feel like you're alone, because he'll comfort you if you trust him. Lean on the Holy Spirit of God. Aren't you thankful for his mercy this morning? Aren't you thankful for the Holy Spirit this morning? Is that song so beautifully sung this morning? It's not about us. It's all about him. Amen. Amen. Kind of remind me of that scripture over there where Paul says in Galatians 2:20, Paul says, it's no longer about me. It's no longer I that lives. But the life that I am now living, I'm living by what? Faith in the Son of God. He's trusting the Son of God. Paul got a revelation of who he was in Christ when Christ came to him and he fell to the ground. He was going after Christians to crucify, to torment, to destroy. But on his way, Holy Spirit intervened. Hallelujah. And from that moment on, Paul got such a revelation. Paul wrote over half of the New Testament. Over the half of the New Testament. Why? Because he had such a revelation of what happened to him. We need to not just look back and say, well, I thank God I'm saved, and I thank God I'm going to heaven when I die. That's wonderful. But there is so much more in our new birth. There's so much more in our new creation. As Paul says, I've become a new creation. All things have passed away and all things have become new. And we need to look at our life and see God in us in such a way that every day is a day of comfort. Every day is a day of strength. Every day is a day knowing that He stands by me. You heard people say, well, they didn't stand by me. You can never say that about the Holy Spirit. He'll always stand by you. He'll always walk with you. He'll always talk to you. Well, Robert brought a revelation to me many years ago when he said, you know, somebody said, well, the Holy Spirit's never speaking to me. He said, because you're not listening. Amen. The Holy Spirit's always talking, always talking to us. Amen. And the more you read the Word, the more He'll talk to you. See, the Bible is supernatural. I said, the Bible is supernatural. It's just not letter and paper. It's the supernatural Word of God. People have tried to destroy the Bible and to deny there's a God for many centuries, but they cannot. The more they try to discredit the kingdom of God, the bigger He gets. I said, the bigger He gets. He said, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, He'll teach you all things. I said, He'll teach you all things. He'll teach me all things. There's been many times in my life as a child of God, I've got before God, I said, Lord, I just don't understand what's going on or what I need to do. And many times I begin to hear Him say, He said, if you don't know what to do, don't do anything. Amen. Sometimes we rush into stuff. We rush into stuff. Make sure whatever you're doing in life that you're led by the Holy Spirit. Because when we are led by the Holy Spirit of God, you'll always come out on top. You'll always come out blessed. You'll always come out healed. You'll always come out the best. Amen. In every area of your life. But we must learn to listen to the Holy Spirit. And it seemed like the more I pray on this, the more I meditate on this, I begin to see what the Holy Spirit is telling us to talk to and minister on this subject for some time. And Jason finished his class this morning for several weeks on the Holy Spirit. And God, as I said last week, I believe it was, trying to get our attention, how important it is for us not to take it lightly of the power of the Holy Spirit that is in us. We find in Romans 8:11, it says that that same resurrection power that raised Christ from the dead lives on the inside of us. That same anointing, that same power. We are anointed in Revelation chapters 1, verse 5 and 6 says we are kings and we are priests. We have the anointing, not just people or pastors or ministers behind the pulpit, but the body of Christ. We are all anointed to do the work of the kingdom, praise God. Because of the Holy Spirit, He just doesn't pick out one here and one there. He picks us up. He picks us all out. We're all ministers of the gospel. We all may not preach behind a pulpit. We all may not be carpenters. We all may not be painters. We all may not be electricians. Or we may not all be computer experts. But I tell you what we all are. We're all anointed to preach the gospel, to teach the gospel to the world. Everywhere we go, we need to share the power of the Holy Spirit. That same power, that same power that raised Christ from the dead. It took the power of God to get Jesus out of hell. That same power that snatched Him out of the jaws of hell lives on the inside of us. It'll snatch you out of every bad situation that you find yourself in. That's the power of the Holy Spirit. He'll snatch you right out of stuff. I'm drinking mighty early up here this morning. That same power, I get to think about that power. We should sing that song. It's power, power, wonder-working power, wonder-working power. And that power is working in us. He said, He'll teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. Amen. Now, I'm always praying. I said, Lord, I thank you. I've got the mind of Christ. I've got a great memory. I can remember stuff, and I can remember a lot of stuff. And I'm going to continue to have my mind because I got the mind of Christ. I got the mind of Christ. You got the mind of Christ. And we're going to confess every day. He's my strengthener. He's my helper. He's my standby. I have the mind of Christ. Amen. And we're going to be sharp. We're not going to be forgetful. And if I do forget something, I say, Holy Spirit, help me. Remind me of that. Amen. He said, bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. Verse 27 said, peace. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled. Don't let it be afraid. Amen. In other words, he said, don't be concerned. Amen. Don't be concerned about all the troubles. Now, they were in a lot of bad situations back there when Jesus was on the earth. I mean, they were crucifying a lot of people before. He just didn't start the crucifixion. It started 700 years before Jesus was crucified. They talked about it 700 years before he was crucified. So they must have been in acts of crucifying people many years ago. He even burned people at the stake way back, way back. But Jesus says, don't be afraid. You have the peace of God. Why? Because we have the Holy Spirit. That's why it's so important for you to stir up. Jude says, stir up the gift of the Holy Spirit on the inside of you. Why do you need to be stirred up? Because it will bring you in remembrance of how powerful he is and the working power of the Holy Spirit living on the inside of us. Amen? Amen? Be not drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. Anybody want to be more filled with the Holy Spirit? Amen. Just keep drinking. Amen. Just keep drinking. Amen. I said, look at your neighbor and say, just keep drinking. But make sure it's the Holy Spirit you're drinking. And if you keep drinking the Holy Spirit, keep being filled and refilled, refilled and refreshed, you're going to really enjoy your walk with God. I mean, walking with God is such a joy because you know somebody's walking with you. I'm not alone. You are not alone. And that's why he says in Galatians 5:16, walk in the Spirit and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Amen. Walk in the Spirit and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Amen. Let me read something here by John G. Lake. It's been a long time since I've read this, but it talks about the Holy Spirit. He says, the Word of God again says that our flesh shall rejoice, not our mind, but our very flesh shall rejoice. The presence of God is to be a living presence, not only in the spirit of man, nor in the mind of man alone, but also in the flesh of man, so that God is known in every department of our life. Every department of our life. We know God in our very flesh. We know God in our mind. We know God in our spirit. The media by which God undertakes to bless the world is through the transmission of himself. Now the Spirit of God is his own substance, the substance of his being, the very nature and quality, the very presence and being and the nature of God. Consequently, when we speak of the Spirit of God being transmitted to man and into man, we're not talking about an influence, either spiritual or mental. We're talking about the transmission of the living substance and being of God into your being and into my being. The living substance of God. It's a reality. He's a person living on the inside of us. Not a mental effect, but a living substance. Think about that for a moment. A living substance. The living being. An actual life transmitted, imparted, coming from God into your very being, into my being. Praise God. Amen. That is the secret of the abundant life of which Jesus spoke of. Jesus says, I am come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. He says, I've come that you might have life. Now we have life because we have Jesus by the Holy Spirit living inside of us. Now we need to have it more abundantly. Amen. He didn't just say it in abundance, but he said more abundantly. The reason we have the more abundant life is because that receiving God into our being, all the springs of our being are quickened by his living presence. Consequently, if we are living today and we receive God, we live life in a full measure. Full measure. Are you listening to me this morning? Fully measure. Everybody say fully measure. Because we become a recipient of the energy of the living God in addition to our normal energy. We got God's energy, plus we have our energy. Though the recipient of this being, his nature, his life is our life. Is our life. The wonderful measure that the human being is capable of receiving God is demonstrated by some of the most incidents that ever happened in the Word of God. For instance, the most remarkable in the Scripture is the transfiguration of Jesus himself, where Peter, James, and John, the Spirit of God came upon him and powerfully came upon him that related through his being filled, the glory, in Matthew 17, 1 through 9, being clothed, white, remnant came, and glistening, and the face of him shone. In other words, Peter, James, and John was on the Mount of Transfiguration. Who they see up there? Anybody know who they saw up there? Saw Moses. Their eyes were open. Such a supernatural happening took place. They wanted to build three tabernacles. The supernatural eyes were open that they could see. When you are filled with the Holy Spirit of God, the supernatural power of God will open your eyes that you may see. We think we are doing well when we see with our natural eyes. But you're going to do a lot better when we can see with our spiritual eyes. Amen. Are you listening to me this morning? Amen. We need to be alive under God. We need to be alive under God. And when we are walking in the Spirit, we are alive under God. But there's some things that we have to do. Let's look over here in Romans chapter 6. If you'll pull that up on the Amplified Bible for me. Romans chapter 6 and verse 1. Say, I'm alive unto God. Romans chapter 6, and I'm going to read this out of the Amplified Bible. What shall we say to all this? Are we to remain in sin in order that God's grace and favor and mercy may multiply and overflow? Then Paul says, certainly not. How can we who died to sin live in it any longer? Are you ignorant of the fact that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Notice verse 4, we were baptized, therefore, or buried, therefore, with him by the baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, so we too might inhabit, live, and behave in newness of life. Because of the power of the Holy Spirit of God, we have a newness of life. Verse 5 says, for if we have become one with him, if we have become one with him by sharing a death like this, we shall also be one with him in sharing his resurrection by a new life lived for God. Amen. Verse 6 says this, for we know that our old unrenewed self was nailed to the cross with him. Amen. We were nailed to the cross with him. Amen. Our flesh was nailed to the cross with him in order that our body, which is the instrument of sin, might be made ineffective and inactive for evil, that we might no longer be the slaves of sin. Glory to God. My body's not going to tell me what to do. I'm going to tell my body what to do. Your body will tell you things that will cause sin to reign and rule in your life, because your body is still a sinful nature. This body is a sinful nature. Many times I've said in this ministry, we have to take charge over this nature because it's a sin nature. We are a new creation on the inside, but this body's not saved. How many have found that out? this body is not saved. He says in verse 7, for when a man dies, he's free and loose, delivered from the power of sin among men. When a man dies, he's talking about when he gets born again, you die to your flesh. Amen. When you get born again, when you receive Jesus Christ as your Savior, you die to your flesh, or should die to your flesh. In other words, if you keep allowing your flesh to do things after you got born again, after you've nailed it to the cross, there's no more sacrifice for it. But Jesus made a way by saying to us, if we sin, he didn't want you to sin, but if you do sin, we have an advocate with the Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. He says here in verse 7, and when a man dies, he is free, loose, delivered from the power of sin among men. Now, if we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, because we know that Christ, the anointed one, being once raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has power over him. For by the death he died to sin, ending his relation to it. He ended his relation to it once and for all, and the life that he lives, he is living to God in unbroken fellowship with him. Now let me start with that verse 10. He's living unto God, unbroken fellowship. You and I, we have a relationship with God. Amen. But through the whole relationship is a new birth. That's when you get born again, you have a relationship. Now, the fellowship comes when you're meditating in the Word of God, fellowshipping with him in the Word of God. That's why it's so important for us to fellowship in the Word of God. Amen. Because we're fellowshipping with him. So you cannot separate the Word from him. Because John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And God is the Word. Amen. Amen. Now, remember here about four weeks ago, we talked about, went back to Genesis. We talked about when God made man and put him in a garden, then he made Eve, put Adam to sleep and took a rib out of him and made Eve. Now, he also made a beautiful garden. He told them this in chapter 2 of Genesis, eat every tree in the garden. Everyone but one. Everybody say one. What is it that when somebody tells you don't touch that one thing? When Gil was little, I said, Gil, don't touch that. He said, we all have done that. Don't do that. Do play with everything else, but don't touch that. God says, now, Adam, Eve, you got all this garden, you got all the gold, all the silver, all the sapphire, all you need. You got everything you need, but there's one tree in this garden. Don't you touch it. And then you got a snake, Satan, comes into the garden. You know there's a snake in every garden. Came in and told Eve to go ahead and partake of that tree. He says, now God don't want you to protect it. Now he'll tell you some things God said, which was right. God says not to take it, but he added some lie to it. He said, once you protect it, you're going to be smart as God. So she convinced her husband. Timothy said, I believe it's in Timothy, where he says that Adam was not deceived. Eve was deceived, but Adam knew better, but he gave in anyway. He said, that's a tree of knowledge of good and evil. See, he didn't want them to know evil. God is knowledge. Remember, God would come down in the cool of the day, fellowship with Adam and Eve, fellowship. He loves fellowshipping. One day he came down and he called out, Adam, Adam, where art thou? He hid himself. Why? Because he had disobeyed. See, sometimes we disobey, but see, God in Genesis 3:15, God corrected the disobedience by preparing himself to come. He says, I'm going to bruise his head. I'm going to bruise the devil's head. But look how many years it took from Genesis, the third chapter, verse 15, to get all the way to Matthew chapter 1. those years, all those years it took. See, when we get into disobedience, sometimes there's a price to pay. God will forgive you. He'll love you. But he don't want you to sin, as I said earlier. He don't want you to mess up, but he'll still love you. He'll still love us and forgive us. Amen. But go back to the garden for a moment. He says, now you got everything you need. All you need. You got me as your father. I'll come down and fellowship with you. The Holy Spirit came down in fellowship with Adam and Eve. See, Jesus was born in human flesh in Matthew chapter 1. But Jesus has always been. He's always been. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, all three, they've always been. Amen. It was just in Matthew chapter 1. The Father looks over there at the Son and says, I got to send you down. It's about time for me to deliver my people. Give them a hope. Give them a way out. See, Moses couldn't do it. He killed a man. Abraham couldn't do it. He lied about his wife. David couldn't do it. He had Bathsheba's husband killed. So we see the mistakes of men all through the Bible, but God still loved them. But those mistakes caused them not to fulfill God's perfect plan in their life. I want God's perfect plan in my life. Perfect plan in my life. David, he sinned with Bathsheba, made a big mistake, but see, he always was a man of prayer. He'd go into the temple 10 times a day he'd go into the temple, and 3 out of the 10 he prayed, and the other 7 times he'd give God thanks. 7 out of 10 he thanking God for his goodness and for his mercy. And the other 3 times, he was just praying. Just praying. And then he said, my heart's after God. My heart's after God. Joshua said, his heart is after me. And David says in Psalms, I believe it was 50, 51, he says, God created a new heart in me. Because David spent some time praying. Spending time before the Father, thanking God. And the reason that I brought that out, the Holy Spirit leading me to bring that out, because God's trying to show us this, we need to spend more time thanking him. Thanking him. We ought to get up every day and thank God for the Holy Spirit who guides us and leads us in every area of our life. Thank God for his goodness. I'm so thankful. I'm telling you, church, I am so thankful I'm saved. Yes. I'm so thankful I didn't die early in life without Jesus. Because I believe with all my heart, if I hadn't got born again, I wouldn't be here today. Because I was on a fast track to hell. A fast track. But I'm so thankful. My wife got saved. She prayed. Don't ever give up on your husbands, ladies. Guys, don't ever give up on your wife. Just trust God. Don't ever give up on your family members, a friend. Don't ever give up on them. I don't care how bad things look. The Holy Spirit can do more in 1 second than we can do in a lifetime. If we'll just start spending more time thanking God for their life coming to Jesus, praising God because they're coming to Jesus, and spending so much time talking to other people about how bad they are. What was it, 2 or 3 weeks ago, talking about, you know, we need to be people that welcomes everybody, love everybody. We don't have to like everybody, and we don't have to like everybody's ways. And definitely, we're not going to like people's sin. I said, we're not going to like nobody's sin. Amen? Amen? Praise God. Verse 10, let's go back to verse 11. Even so, consider yourselves also dead to sins, and your relation to it broken, but alive to God, living in unbroken fellowship with him in Christ Jesus. Let not sin. Now notice what he said in verse 12. Let not. We are in charge. See, there's things that God will do for us, and there's things he won't do for us. And what he puts us in charge of, we have to do it, and God will manifest it. Amen. Amen. He says in Luke 10, 19, he says, I give you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. I give you the authority. So the authority he's given us, he's not going to take the authority away from us. And if we want things done, we got to take the authority. We have the Holy Spirit backing us. We have the Holy Spirit living in us, and he's backing us. And we have the authority. He says in verse 12, let not therefore sin, let not sin therefore rule as king in your mortal, short-lived, perishable bodies, to make you yield to its cravings and be subject to its lusts and evil passions. Do not continue offering or yielding your body members and faculties to sin as instruments, tools of wickedness, but offer and yield yourselves to God. Thank you for your enthusiasm. But offer and yield yourselves to God as though you have been raised from the dead, and your bodily members and faculties to God, presenting them in implements of righteousness. In other words, we need to act like we're saved. As children of God, we need to act like we are saved. And we need to act like we have the love of God living inside of us. And we need to act like we have the power of God inside of us. So when we are challenged, we don't give in to it. We don't fall apart. We rely on the Holy Spirit inside of us to help us through. He'll help us through whatever we're going through, whatever we're dealing with. The Holy Spirit is always there. I said, he'll help you. Verse 14, for sin shall not. Now, when we talk about sin here, I should have mentioned this earlier, and I may have. For sin, talking about the sin nature shall not any longer exert dominion or have dominion over you, since now you are not under the law or slaves, but under grace, as subjects of God, favor and his mercy. We're not under the law of sin. Law of sin has been dealt with the blood of Jesus. Thank God we have the authority in us over this sinful nature. This is an Adamic nature. This is a sinful nature. We have the nature of Adam since we fell. But thank God for Jesus, who brought back the nature of God through the Holy Spirit to live on the inside of us. I said the Holy Spirit lives inside. It's amazing. He's living inside this temple. This sinful nature. Why? To give us resurrection life and to make us more than conquerors. Paul got that revelation in Romans 8 chapter. More than conquerors. I'm not a conqueror. I'm more than a conqueror because of the Holy Spirit. It's all about him and not about me. Amen. Verse 15, what then we come to conclude, shall we sin because we live under the law but under God's favor and merit? Paul says, absolutely not. We don't live in sin. Do you not know that if you continually surrender yourselves to anyone to do his will, you are the slaves of him whom you obey, whether that be to sin, who leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness, right standing and right standing with God. Amen. I'm not going to let my body keep me in slavery. My body's not going to keep me in slavery. Amen. I'm not going to be a slave to alcohol, drugs, pornography. Thank you for those three amens. We'll record those. I'm not going to be a slave to it. Now, we all have the temptation. We all have this temptation. The reason people yield to the temptation is because they are overriding the Holy Spirit. A person saved, baptized in the Holy Ghost, speak with other tongues, can still yield to pornography, drugs, alcohol, any type of sin, they can still yield to it. But you don't have to. God says, I have put you in charge of your own body. Amen. And by the power, see, I'm getting you to recognize we have a helper on the inside of us to help us to withstand that temptation. And the day we live again to this day and time, there's more temptation out there than ever before. More temptation. Just because something looks like it's okay, you better pray about it. Because a lot of stuff that looks like it's okay is not okay. It's a trap. It's a trap. You cannot catch a rat with a bone. You got to have some cheese. You got to have some cheese to catch a rat. Amen? Because I knew years ago we was living somewhere, and many, many, many years ago, we had little mice. I couldn't stand those things. Went by those little old-fashioned wood traps, put them behind the refrigerator, behind the stove, and behind everything we could. And once in a while, you're thinking, pop! Got him. Got him. The devil will try to trap you with some cheese, and when he hears the pop of you yielding to it, I got him. I got him. We're all going to be tested. We are all going to be tried. And we have to know who lives inside of us. And we have to know that we have the authority to overcome it. Yes, the flesh is weak. But let the weak say,
I am strong.
Let the weak say,
I am strong.
Let the weak say,
I am strong.
Don't forget that.
Amen.
When a time of weakness overrides you, opposite sex, fornication,
amen.
Adultery. Why are you saying all this for, Pastor? I'm saying all this because if you listen to the Holy Spirit and submit to the Holy Spirit, he'll help you through that. You don't need somebody else's wife, think you're going to be better off. You don't need a kid committing. Let me explain the difference between, in case you don't know, you should know this, between fornication and adultery. Fornication is when you're married and you have a relationship with somebody else. That's adultery. No, it's not. It's adultery. No. Listen to me. Adultery is when you have a relationship when you're married to somebody. And you have a relationship with somebody else. Fornication is when you're having sex before you get married. God says he hates both of it. But God will forgive you. Because if he didn't forgive us, we'd all be in hell right now. We might as well just forget it and throw it all away. Hey. See, you thought I was going to pinpoint somebody. No, we're pinpointing all of us. But once you've been set free from something, we need to stay free from it. Stay free from it. That's what we have to do. I'm not going to read the rest of it. Read, you got a Bible. Read the rest of it. The only way we can do that is to be full of the Holy Spirit to the point that we see him who is invisible. And then we find in Romans 4:17, call those things which be not as though they were. And the only way we can do that is to see him who is invisible. Turn with me, please, quickly to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Still got your Bible? Chapter 4, verse 16. Therefore, we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. And how's that happening? By the Holy Spirit of God. Verse 17, for our light affliction, which is just for a moment. God calls, Paul says, this is a light affliction. What you're challenged with is light. Somebody said, man, that's the worst thing I've ever been challenged with. Still light. Your light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Verse 18, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Amen. Hello? In other words, things that we do see that are temporary are subject to change when we can see into the supernatural, which is through the Word of God. Amen? Amen. Go to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, let's look at verse 23. By faith Moses, when he was born, was hidden 3 months by his parents, because they saw he was a beautiful child, and they were not afraid of the king's command. See, when you are full of the Holy Ghost, you're not going to be afraid of anything. Amen. What they were saying here, we're going to obey God. I don't care what the king said, we're going to obey God. Amen. It's coming down to a place now. Whether we're going to obey the government, our leaders in our state, leaders in our city, or are we going to obey God? Amen. They are not God. I will not let that happen to me. God is my source. Amen. And when they try to tell me that I can't preach the Bible, I'm going to preach it. We may be tested in that area. Many people are tested right now across this country. In the United States of America, people are tested about their faith. Your faith is going to be tested. Pastor Barr was telling me something about a bus driver was fussing out one of the little kids. And, I mean, just really laid this little child out, what, about 6 years old? 14? Was it 14? Y'all have heard the same thing? They don't need me preaching then. No, I'm just 14-year-old girl, bus driver, she chewed her out and got off the bus, and make a long story short, her mother told her, said, let's do something. Let's go make this bus driver some cookies. Amen. Next day, I think it was the next day, the young girl took some cookies to the bus driver, and I guess the bus driver was in shock. And she took the cookies, and she said, can I have a hug too? Amen. See, the goodness of God, Amen. If you have anyone that may be you feel like an enemy to you, go bake them some cookies. If anybody hadn't treated you right, do something special for them. Amen. On your job, you know, people are always running into real hardship, especially if they know you're a Christian. You run into some challenges. But if you have some people challenging you and making fun of you or laughing at you, and just make a bunch of cookies, bring them and hand them out one day. Amen. Even though you may have one or two, may throw it in the trash can. That's all right. Just praise God anyway. Amen. Amen. Just praise God anyway. Amen. But they decide here, we're just going to obey God, not the king's command. Verse 24, by faith Moses, when he became of age, he refused. Everybody say refused. He refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. Amen. Now he made a real choice there. He said, I'm going to suffer the affliction of the people than to give into it.
Amen.
He made a choice. And why did he do that? It says in verse 27, by faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king. Not fearing the wrath of the king, for he fled. He didn't go leave Egypt because he was afraid. Amen. At that time, he probably really didn't know why he was leaving.
Amen.
He says here in this verse, for he endured, notice here, not fearing the wrath of the king. He left Egypt, but not in fear.
Amen.
For he endured as seeing him who is invisible.
Amen.
Seeing him who is invisible. There's always more with us than is with them.
Amen.
And I want to get into this next week. Talk about more is with us than it is with them.
Amen.
How you must see him who is invisible. Not just when you have a need. Not just when you're under attack physically or financially. But every day you recognize him as someone that you can see and depend on to help you through whatever you're going through.
Amen.
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 Stand up with me, please.
Amen.
Seeing him who is invisible. We never did get to the part, the character of a new man. We'll try to get to that next week. There's so much that we want to bring out on this. We're going to talk about Elijah. Elijah. Seeing chariots. He told his servant, look, there's more with us than it is with them. And that's what happens when you begin to live in the Spirit, begin to trust God. You'll never be afraid of anything that threatens your life or threatens you in any way, because you'll always see him who's invisible.
Amen.
Always. We've all had challenges. I've had challenges. I know what many of you have been through, because I've been through it too, also. But you got to keep standing. You just got to keep standing and trusting God with all your heart and believing in a God that you know that's alive. He can do, as I said earlier, he can do more in 1 second than we can do in a lifetime. Sometimes we got to take our hands off some situations.
Amen.
And let the Holy Spirit move.
Amen.
Sometimes we sing that song, Move Holy Spirit. He's always moving. Always moving.
Amen.
And we want to trust him to move in our situation. Because there are friends and families that we pray for, and we sometimes try to help God out and we make it worse.
Amen.
What they need from us is prayer and love.
Amen.
And speaking life over their life.
Amen.
Did you hear what I just said? Speaking life over their life. Not speaking death, but speaking life.
Amen.
That's so important. Because death and life is in the power of the tongue.
Amen.
Proverbs 18:21. Death and life is in the power of the tongue. Speak life over someone. Stop talking against your employees or your supervisor or whoever's over charge of you in your workplace. Speak life to that person. Speak life to it. We've used Tim many, many times. His testimony is so powerful. When the whole company made an announcement, they're not giving no raises. But Tim said these words, that don't apply to me. 2 weeks later, wasn't it? 2 weeks later, he got a promotion.
Amen.
With an announcement from his company, no more promotions at this time.
Amen.
But he said,
Amen.
You say,
Speaking.
And I say,
Speaking.
That don't apply to me.
Amen.
I said, that don't apply to me.
Amen.
Because I'm a child of the King.
Amen.
I'm a child of the King. Amen. Heavenly Father, we lift our voices, we lift our hands, we glorify the wonderful name of Jesus. You're so precious. always there on time. Holy Spirit, you're never late in guiding us and teaching us. As we'll continue to listen to you, be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Because we know that you are a miracle-working God. And there's nothing, Mark 9:23, there's nothing impossible to the believer. Nothing is impossible to the believer. Say that with me. Nothing is impossible to me if I believe. Amen. You born again? Raise your hand. Say, I thank God I'm saved. Come on, say it out loud like you mean it. One more time. See, the devil hates to hear that. The devil hates to hear that. You ought to get up of a morning time and say, thank God I'm saved. Thank God this is a glorious day. Thank God I have the favor of God on my life. Thank God everything good is coming to me from the north, the south, the east, and the west. Thank God I'm healed. Thank God I'm blessed. Thank God for what I have. Not complaining about what I don't have. Thank God for what you do have. If you're not born again, raise your hand so Pastor Phil can pray for you. Anyone, anywhere, raise your hand. God loves you this morning. God cares about you. He loves you. Your time is short. Time is short. If you don't think time has been short, go look in the mirror. And you're going to say something like this. Where has time gone? I remember before David got married, he was getting ready to build a house and there on that property. Weeds was out there. We were standing out there, and I said, Debbie, one day before you realize it, you're going to have children, and they'll be grown, and they'll be married before you know about it, before you can even realize what's happening. I look at my wife and I said, my God, I can't believe it's been 52 years or 53? 52? Going on 53 years. Amen. Married for 53 years. I remember back as a 17-year-old boy getting ready to turn 18. I remember this just like it was yesterday. I said, I wonder who's going to end up being my wife. I didn't have many choices anyway, but I was wondering. And the one that I really wanted, I had to really go after it, I'm telling you. I said, I wonder who's going to be my wife. I wonder what kind of kids we're going to have. I don't have to wonder about that no more.
Amen.
Those years was over 50, almost 55 years ago. Those years have gone by. I heard one preacher say one time he was sitting in his house and his aunts was around and aunts and uncles around and they were talking about, where's all the old people at? He looked around and said, you're looking at the old people. They said, where's time gone? The important thing is, it's not about where time has gone. The important thing is, what are we going to do with the time we have left?
Amen. Amen, Pastor. Yes.
What are we going to do with the time we have left?
Right.
Are we going to live in misery? Are we going to live in doubt and unbelief? Or are we going to be happy? We're going to live, I'm going to be a happy person. Happy life. Happy life. My days are going to be happy. My days are going to be in rejoicing. Sure, time has gone by quick. But the time I got left, the time I got left belongs to God. I said the time I have left belongs to God. Amen. Pray this prayer with me this morning. Say, I thank God for saving me. Deliver me and setting me free. Thank God for the blood. Thank God for the favor. Thank God for every need is met in my life. The devil's defeated. He's under my feet. This is a glorious day. Every day is a glorious day, but I have the Holy Spirit living inside of me. And the favor of God is all over me. I believe that in Jesus' name. Amen. I said, amen. Tell somebody before you leave, the favor of God's all over me.